here at the Vicksburg Battlefield in Vicksburg, Mississippi. And it was my birthday, and I wanted to do something special. So we decided to come to Vicksburg, to the battlefield, because I hadn't been here yet. To start off, I'm going to actually talk about some of the key players first. You've got Grant first, Ulysses S. Grant. You've got also William Sherman, who's underneath him, General McPherson, and General McClernand. On the Confederate side, you've got Pemberton and Joe Johnston. A little bit about Pemberton is that he actually is from Pennsylvania. The only reason he's on the Confederate side is because his wife told him, "No, you're gonna fight for my home country, Virginia." Pemberton is technically a Yankee, but he's serving on the Confederate side. So to really start off of how they get to Vicksburg is that Grant and his army have been working their way from Tennessee down into the Mississippi River. So in 1862, you've got the Battle of Fort Henry, Fort Donaldson, Corinth, Mississippi, Shiloh. Now Corinth, Mississippi falls in October of 1862, and then Grant is making his way further down Mississippi. Now the reason that it is important to be conquering the Mississippi, as I've stated in previous videos, is that it's a supply line. Now, you might be thinking like, okay, well, half of the Mississippi up through Tennessee is already taken, and then also in Louisiana, they've got the southern half of the Mississippi River pretty much taken over, because Louisiana and New Orleans fall pretty early. So there's really only a stretch between Vicksburg and Fort Hudson that is open still to trade. Now, there's really no way in or out of that section of the river, but what's important is what's going across the river. To the west, you've got Texas and Louisiana. Both provide major supplies for the Confederate Army. In Texas, you've got all the beef. Louisiana, you've got the salt and the sugar that's trying to come across that river to get into the heart of the Confederacy. That section of the Mississippi is what Grant is aiming for. He's got to close down Vicksburg, which is also a major, it's a port city, it's right on the Mississippi River, but also it is a railroad hub, just like Shiloh and Corinth were. In December of 1862, he is trying to probe around Vicksburg. He is going down creeks and estuaries trying to get into Vicksburg. This entire time when Grant is trying to get to Vicksburg is a span of probably about 6 to 7 months through, because Lincoln said that Vicksburg is the key to the South and to winning the war. On the western side of the Mississippi is Louisiana. So he comes through Louisiana, down all the creeks and the swamps and everything through there, and his aim is for Grand Gulf, which is south of Vicksburg. The gunboats, they have run the gauntlet past Vicksburg's defenses and all the way down to Grand Gulf. So you've got the Union gunboats are clashing with Confederate fortresses around Grand Gulf, and they are just bombarding each other. He's not getting anywhere. And according to some sources, a slave actually came up to Grant and was like, "Hey, there's an easier way to cross this river a little bit further south." He's like, okay. They go a little bit further south, and sure enough, the fortifications are not that great, and it's a lot easier to cross. So Grant finally crosses the Mississippi. Shortly afterward, Grand Gulf does fall. Grant, instead of making a direct northern approach into Vicksburg, he decides to go a little bit further east. He does this wide sweep across the middle of Mississippi, all the way to Jackson, which is the capital. And this throws Pemberton, who is in Vicksburg, off a little bit. And he doesn't know whether to follow, whether to maintain the city, or at Jackson is fighting Joe Johnston. Now, because of the suddenness of the attack, and along this way, Grant has been cutting up railroads, he's been cutting the telegraph lines, so communication has severely been crippled for the Confederacy. By the time he gets to Jackson, Joe can't hold him off any longer. He ends up retreating further east. He does send a warning to Pemberton saying, defend the city as much as possible. However, Pemberton doesn't get that telegram until like days later. So then Grant starts following up the railroad that goes east to west. And you've got the battle at Champion's Hill, which is where him and Pemberton do finally clash, because Pemberton has decided to leave Vicksburg and make his way east to confront Grant to get him before he gets to the city. A lot of the heavy fighting occurs during the Vicksburg campaign. Pemberton is forced back, and Grant advances towards Vicksburg. Grant does reach Vicksburg in May of 1863, and that's where he's got a few major battles. You've got Sherman to the north, you've got McPherson to the far east, and then a little bit further south, you got McClernand. across miles on the eastern side of Vicksburg. They have built 9 fortifications, 9 forts, earthen forts. And I am actually standing at the 3rd Louisiana Redan. Grant tries to probe around the northern half of the battle lines and then down the eastern side, and he just cannot get through. They've actually tried to dig underneath earthen forts and create mines. And when we say mines, I'm not talking about tunnels, we're talking about bombs. For instance, Petersburg with the Battle of the Crater, same thing occurred here. And this is what happened here at the 3rd Redan. Sherman was trying to get some men over the forts. This one regiment that was called the Forlorn Hope, it was 150 Union men that got sent over onto this fort, and it was just a complete slaughter. One interesting story about the Forlorn Hope is that a 14-year-old boy who was a musician in the Union Army decided to try and help them out. They were out of ammo, so he was running back across the Union lines, ended up getting wounded, found Sherman, and reported that they needed more ammo. And for that, he got the Medal of Honor. Actually, every man from the Forlorn Hope was rewarded a Medal of Honor for their bravery at the Stockade Redan. Despite all of the mines, despite all of the hard hits that Grant tries to do, he cannot get through. The fortifications are that good. Grant loses over 3,000 men. Pemberton only loses like hundreds. It's that severe of a one-sided kind of battle there. They decide to siege the place, and it's kind of like how at Atlanta, when they're sieging the city there, it's just a constant bombardment of cannon and rifle fire. Mainly the Union side was building trenches to take cover from the Confederate fire, musket fire from these forts. There was a few times where over a fort or a redan, they were trying to get ladders up, and the ladders were too short. The Confederacy had the high ground, and by the way, this battlefield is massive and it's very hilly. We've been walking the whole thing over the last 2 days. The people in the town of Vicksburg, during the night, they actually took cover in caves that they built into the hillsides to escape the cannon fire and the musket fire, and it's just a constant noise. You've got two sides of it. One side of an account from a woman who lived in Vicksburg said the caves were not as bad as everybody thought, but then there was another one where it was likened to an oven or a living tomb, so to speak, because people were just hiding out in there. They made little niches in the walls to put their books and candles in. They brought furniture down. They had their meals. The siege took place for 47 days. Imagine hearing cannon fire every single day, just completely bombarding for 47 days straight. But what was getting Pemberton was not necessarily the bombardment. They were running out of supplies. He kept cutting the rations for the soldiers because Grant had control of the railroad that was coming in. And then along the Mississippi River, you've got Admiral David Porter. He saw the kind of wisdom in what Grant was doing. So he decided, you know what? Yeah, we're gonna help them out there. So him, along with 3 other admirals in their Ironside gunboats, came down and started bombarding the city from the Mississippi River too. So you've got Vicksburg is getting hammered on both sides by infantry and by the Navy, because he was running out low on supplies, running low on ammo, running low on morale. Like, that kind of environment where it's a siege, like, it takes a mental toll on the soldiers and on the civilians. Dysentery and malaria, because with malaria, this also takes place in May, June, and July of 1863. Summer in Mississippi, not fun, very hot. So you've got all the mosquitoes from the Mississippi River are coming over, and people are getting sick, and they don't have the supplies, they don't have the medicine. Finally, Pemberton, July 4th, 1863, does create surrender terms with Grant. Confederates did give up the city, and they stacked their arms, and they surrendered. Now, Vicksburg is a very, very strategic battle, very strategic victory. A lot of the military tactics nowadays are modeled after what Grant did here in 1863. But a lot of people, like, they'll hear about Vicksburg, but they don't really know. But you hear Gettysburg, people know immediately what you're talking about. Vicksburg is kind of pushed to the wayside, is because, one, it's in the Western Theater. A lot of people don't know what happened in the Western Theater, because a lot of the battles like Antietam, Petersburg, and Gettysburg is all in the Eastern Theater in Virginia and Maryland. And people know those better. They hear about those, or movies are made about them, and they're just more popular. And Gettysburg took place in the early July of 1863 as well. So in the headlines, you've got Gettysburg and Vicksburg side by side, but Gettysburg was over 3 days and had monumental kind of losses compared to Vicksburg. A lot of what happened at Vicksburg, strategically speaking, is just absolutely genius on Grant's part. Grant was promoted after the battle because of taking Vicksburg, and then later Fort Hudson, further down on the Mississippi, was taken over and occupied by the Union Army. And because of that, it effectively severed the whole Confederacy in two. They no longer had that supply train coming in from Louisiana and Texas, so it severely crippled their ability to fight because an army runs on its stomach. So if you don't have any food, you don't have any way to preserve your food, you're kind of screwed.
Thank you.